Service on July 21st at 1 o'clock at Jackson's Lodge. See Frankie Berg for details. On June 21st, there is a family bonfire at 6 o'clock, which is generally behind the building here. Bring something to share. Sugar on Snow is coming up in August on the 3rd at 5 o'clock. If you'd like to help, see Katie, Shelley, or Frankie. We need 6 gallons of syrup in total, and I know we have had some donated. And help for the tables and being responsible for those tables. Please see Katie if you are willing to help out with doing church on Sundays. And if you're interested, please sign up for an email or a snail mail for a monthly church newsletter. At FYI, there are restrooms downstairs, and there are also warm drinks in the back of the church. Are there any other announcements?
I did print out new slips for the newsletter, so if anybody wants to sign up, just give it to Dean. Hey, Dean.
We're starting to work on the sugar on the snow. Next week, I'll have a list for you of all the items that we need, but we're looking particularly for cases that we need, like 140 small bottled water. So if you see, if you're out wandering around and you see that stuff on special, don't hesitate. We need the small ones, then the big ones. What else? The flyers and stuff we can order. But also, Beth is heading up the food table for us this year, so be sure to keep touch base with her on foods that she can bring so she can start coordinating the list on that.
So there will be no women on that group this week. It hasn't been well. All right, let's read scripture together. Second Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 16 through 17. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself
and God our Father love us and give us eternal comfort
and good hope through grace.
Comfort your hearts and establish them in a good word and word.
Thank you, Carmen. So do I have to use the mic? But you did it. Thank you. So when you came in, there were little cards on your seat. You can pick one or two or three of those or how many you want. So we're going to do prayer time as Guatemala did. So you're going to pray out loud while I'm praying out loud. I'm going to turn off my mic and I'm going to pray out loud without using the mic. So if you'd like to pray out loud, it's not popcorn like everybody, just one person, two. But if you want to pray out loud, everybody prays out loud at the same time. It happened in Guatemala, and it's really cool. And then I'll say amen when people are done, okay? So if you take those cards that you're sitting on or that were in your pew, and pray for those things or pray for what you want to pray for out loud. And then when I hear most of it quieted down, then I'll end the prayer, okay? So it's going to be weird because we don't usually do this in America, but everybody's going to pray at the same time. Okay, here we go. God, we are so grateful that we can pray to you, that you listen and you answer according to your will and ours. God, thank you so much for putting these things in our hearts. I know that some of us are struggling with things, or some of us are joyful, or things that are making us happy. God, I just pray that you will be with us and may guide us through the dark times and in the good times. God, thank you so much for these prayers on the cards. I pray that we will have people pray for these throughout the month. And God, thank you so much for letting us be here together. We just love you and thank you. And see you soon. Amen. Hello, kids. Second Thessalonians. Second Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15 says, "So that brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you were taught by us, that's the apostles, either by our spoken word or by our letter." And so we have offering because that's what the first church did. They took up an offering. They helped other people in the town, and they helped people around the area. And it's a good thing to give, and to give our time, our talent, and our money, because God gives us time, talent, money, and it's His. And so where we're putting that is really where our heart is. I've heard preachers say before, wherever your checkbook is, nobody usually does a checkbook. Who does a checkbook anymore? Anyway? Okay, a couple of them. All right. Whatever is in your checkbook is where your heart is. And so we should be giving things away to help other people and for God's glory. And so that's a good thing to do in our life. Let's stand together. We're going to sing to God. And I get to stand here and sing to
Shout your name, Lord.
Amen.
Just pray that you be with us this time. Pray that you feel Frank as he looks your word out. Let your spirit flow through us.
Yes.
In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
You may have a seat. Toddler through fifth grade, you may go down. One of the days when we sing that song that says shout your name, somebody's just going to like shout Jesus. So, anyway, I love those songs. Thanks for making me cry again. Anytime. Right. Good job, Sydney. Whole purpose is to make Frankie cry. No. Whole purpose of singing is to have Jesus as the center, and he's the audience. So no matter if they make mistakes up here, no matter if you make mistakes, no matter if you can't sing or you can sing, or you're crying like a baby and you don't want to sing because the Spirit's moving, it's all about Jesus. It's not about us and about how we sound. Now, these speakers are going to be changed out. They're kind of old, and they're not even supposed to be for an area like this. I found out that they're like speakers used for a computer. So we did buy some, and I'm going to put them in this week. But anyway, that was just going off the rails here. Okay, so we're talking about Paul and his letters that he wrote to the churches, and the churches mean the people, okay? Not a building. And so Paul writes to 2 Thessalonians this letter. Now, 1 Thessalonians was all about encouragement and you're doing a good job, here's what you need to do, and then he ends it. Then 2 Thessalonians is all about, hey, I've heard everything that you're doing, this is great, but here's where it needs to point to, and it needs to point to Jesus. And so we're going to talk about hope today, not the person whose name you have, but hope, as in hoping for the future, hoping for things to come. And so one night at dinner, a man who had spent many summers in Maine fascinated his companions by telling them an experience of a little town called Flagstaff. The town was to be flooded as part of a large lake for which the dam was going to be built. In the months before it was flooded, all improvements and house repairs stopped. Like, they stopped painting, they stopped doing everything, and they didn't do anything for about 6 months. And they were like, why repair anything? Why build anything new? Because it's all going to be wiped out. So week by week, the whole town became more and more bewildered and downtrodden, and the buildings were dilapidated. And the grass was growing. Then he added, by the way, the explanation is where there is no hope for the future, there's no power in the present. Think about that. When we teach children that you're just a pile of cells and you came from a monkey, what are they going to act like? They're going to act like a monkey. They're going to act like a pile of cells. If we teach the children that they have purpose and God loves them, and God is going to use you for a greater thing than themselves, and they have hope for the future, that there's a heaven, that there is going to be a great earth and a great new heaven and new earth, and there's hope in Jesus, what are they going to act like? That there's hope. When we have a future that has no hope, why do anything? Why obey teachers? Why obey the parents? Why obey any law? Who tells me what is right and wrong? Who really gives a care about anything? And we teach people that all the time, that there's no hope, there's nothing after the grave. You're just going to be in with the worms, and you're going to be worm food. Now we know better, right? We know that this flesh, this earth, is in pain with sin. Sin and the fallen earth. Sin has fallen us, befell us. Our flesh is weak. Trust me, I try to sleep for 2 or 3 days now, and I can't because stuffiness and sore throat and stuff like that. Hopefully it is allergies because we're going on vacation here in a little bit. Because I'm always sick on vacation. Why is that? My body doesn't like vacation. So, as we're looking at vacation, we have hope that I'm not sick, hope that we have fun, hope that we have safety. Now, who do I put my hope in? Not the car, not Katie's driving, not Andrew's driving, not my driving. I put hope in Jesus that he'll get us there safe. Now, if he doesn't, is Jesus still Jesus?
Yeah.
See, that's the difference. We still have hope, even if it's a storm rounds. And I love that. But when we have lawlessness, when we have people who are just don't care about anything, don't care about flesh, don't care about spirit, don't care about mental or emotional or physical or nothing, then we lose hope. And we see the evidence in culture. Well, if we're just going to be flesh, why don't we just do whatever we want? Why is there a law? We just should be lawless, right? We should be like back in the those old westerns that your dad likes to watch. Oh, Gunsmoke, you know. I'm the sheriff in this town. Anyway. So I want you to turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to be in that the whole time. So just open your Bibles, open your apps, open your minds to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 1 through 12. And it will be up here also. So this is the second letter of Paul to the Thessalonica church. And when we have lack of hope for those who follow lawlessness. And you're thinking, what is lawlessness? Well, it's really saying, I don't like the law, so I'm going to do what I want. Gee, that's not happening today, is it? I don't care what the law says. I'm just going to do whatever I want. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 1 through 12. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and he is coming back. I am hopeful, that is joy, that is grace, that is just beyond belief that he's coming back. And our being gathered together to him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word, or a letter seeming to be from us to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Somebody was preaching back then. There were groups of people preaching, oh, Jesus already came back. You missed it. Or Jesus already come back. You just need to do whatever you want, and then you'll die, and then you'll see him after that. But right now, he's already come back. You're good. And Paul's like, no. He hasn't come back. Don't lose your hope. Every generation has picked out somebody that, oh, the world's going to end. They picked out, let me just throw some out there, Hitler. Well, Hitler's reigning, the world's going to end. Let's get together, let's sell all we have, and we're going to stay in a commune. No, I don't have anything wrong with a commune, that's all they do. But they thought the world was going to end. Or Mussolini. Or, I mean, just insert a name into history. And even Christians get deceived about this stuff. Well, there's a name, there's a person, and we're going to focus on the evils that he's doing, or she's doing, and we're going to worry. We're just going to fall apart, we're just going to huddle together, we're just going to cry about it. What does Paul say here? Don't be alarmed. Look, God has it under control. If that person is the man of lawlessness, if that person is the one who's going to bring the end, yes, bring it. I'm grateful for that person. Now, I don't want to follow that person, but I'm grateful that Jesus is coming back and we can say, oh,
yes.
But it shouldn't let us lose hope. It shouldn't keep us up at night. It shouldn't be pointing a finger and yelling at people that you're not doing this, 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 and this. We should still love and we should still bring them to Jesus. Not to be alarmed. Not to lose hope in Jesus. And even, there are tons of books that just make you worry. Like, I just read this book, and man, it just, oh my goodness, we're going to go through this and this. I'd rather read that book and say, hey, there's hope. Now, I'm not saying we don't not read other books, but you got to put it in context of what God has said. He is right. There are some books that I'm like halfway through, I'm like, I'm going to finish it because I'm one of those people. But I'm like, that doesn't match up with Jesus. So I'm just going to throw it on my shelf and be like, okay, that was all right. But stop worrying about that stuff. Now, should we be prepared? Yes. Prepared how? Teach other people about Jesus and love them no matter what they do to us. That's the preparation. Now, here we go. Who is he writing to here? Christians in like a Roman-occupied area. And he's telling us what? Rome. I mean, here's Caesar doing all kinds of stuff to Christians. I mean, if you understand the history of Diocletian after the other Nero, because Nero really hated Christians, but Diocletian, woo, he put Christians on spikes through their derriere and lit them on fire for the pathway to his kingdom. He ripped their flesh off and made flesh suits. And we're like, oh, that's bad today. And you know what the Christians did? They loved other people and prepared themselves. You think they thought Jesus was coming back then? Yeah. Did they worry about it? No. Because Paul was saying, look, don't worry about this stuff. Look at verse 3. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first. How much are rebellions out there? Yeah. And the man, yes, there is going to be one person, of lawlessness, is revealed, the son of destruction. So who's the person of destruction? Yeah, the Antichrist, or the devil, okay? And so, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God.
What?
Yeah, it tells you. There's going to be a person who's going to say, I am God. Worship me. Now, I don't think those exact words are going to come out of it. Maybe he will. I don't know. But he's going to put himself to the highest point that all nations have a choice. It's either him or death. But then people are like squirming in their seats. They're like, when is that going to happen? When's my choice? I don't know what to do. I'm like, yes, you do. Stay with Jesus. Don't be deceived by these lies or these falsehoods. How do we know what is false? We study the truth. Look at verse 5. Do you not remember when I was still with you? I told you these things. And you know what is restraining him now so that he may be revealed in his time. Who's holding him back?
Holy Spirit.
Yeah, God. Remember, God is in control. You are not. Is the government in control? No. Is the world in control? No. Who's in control? God. Look at this. This is awesome. For the mystery of the lawlessness is already at work. I could have told you that. Only he who restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by appearance of his coming. Holy moly. The breath. All that God has to do is breathe. And he's dead. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of who? Satan. With all power and false signs and wonders. What are we just thinking about? In signs and wonders. Who? God. Not somebody on earth who claims to be God. Not somebody who's healing left and right and bones and flesh and healing and saying that I am God. When we start seeing that, I'm telling you what, you better get right with Jesus more and more. Hold on to the truth, not this person who thinks he's God. Look at verse 10. And with all wicked deception, for those who are perishing, because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. Who's he talking to? He's talking to the world. Who's he talking to in this letter? Christians. Christians will be deceived. Why? Because they don't want to read this. They don't want to stay with the truth. They don't want a foundation in Jesus. They just want to say, well, I did my Sunday duties, and that's bad. That's good. And they'll be deceived. Paul's like, don't be deceived. Look at this, verse 11. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion. Now, is that God's fault? No. Who already chose not to listen to God? These Christians who thought they were Christians. Their faith is in Jesus, and if their faith is in Jesus, then they're believing Jesus, not the world. So that they may believe what is false, in order that all may be condemned who did not believe the, what? Truth. So I keep telling you, believe in Jesus. Don't believe in me. Believe in the truth. Don't believe in my opinions. believe in the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. Man, we should have learned from our history. I mean, look down at history. People claim to be Christians, and they start murdering people in the name of God. Yeah. Or they start raping, or they start doing this, or pillaging, or all kinds of stuff. And they come in the name of God, and then God's name gets defiled because they claim to be Christian. And how do we know if you're a Christian or not? By your actions. And the truth.
And love.
And love. That's why we gotta love our enemies. Even enemies within the church. They've already condemned themselves and their false beliefs. So it's just like Pharaoh. Everybody's like, oh, God hardened their heart. He was already hardened his heart. God's just using it for his glory. Well, he opened the heart of Cyrus. Cyrus was an evil king, and God opened his heart to give money to the Jews to go rebuild, which was just blows my mind. God will open and close hearts because they've chosen to be closed and open. You're either in the way of God's will and it's going to be done, or you're with him and God's will be done. Either way, guess whose will gets done? God's. I'd rather be with him and have joy and have hope and keep the main thing. And I'm like, well, that's really depressing. Well, the second half of this chapter is really hopeful. So Paul's like saying, well, I'm going to warn you, there's going to be some really iffy characters that are going to say that they're God. I believe we're in that point. They're going to believe that they are God, they are the ruler of the world, and you're going to have to pick which one. You're going to have to pick either Jesus or Barabbas. Not about that's a name, but think of it. The crowd screams Barabbas, and they kill Jesus. As Christians, we're going to either have Jesus living in us or with us and make him the king of the world, not this person, or we're going to be deceived and cry Barabbas. We'll take the world. We'll take the thief. And so how do we come out of this? Well, if you're a Christian, if you're with God, you're going to smell like roses, David. This is good. Look at this. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13 through 17. Oh, this is good. But we ought also to give thanks to God for who? You. Brothers and sisters, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved, through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. Man, you are the first fruits. I mean, Jesus resurrected. He gave us the last commission of what we're supposed to do, go into all the world and teach other people about Jesus, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and I'm with you until the end of the age. Oh, that's good. He's given us that truth. He's given us the Holy Spirit that we can have and that we're growing in Christ. Oh, it's going to be glorious. It is still glorious. If you're with Jesus, you're with Jesus now. You don't have to wait till heaven. You know that, right? We're with Jesus. So then, brothers and sisters, oh man, verse 14. To this he called you through our gospel so that you may attain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Not the obtaining of the lawlessness one. Not obtaining the physical attributes of what he's going to provide for us. I don't care what he provides for us. I'm not following him. Throw me in the lion's den. Throw me in the fire. Throw me in jail. I don't care. He's not God. He even told us how he's going to come back, riding on clouds with angels. If that person doesn't have angels to ride on a cloud, amen. Look at verse 15. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by our spoken word or by a letter. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, listen to that. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace. Comfort our hearts and establish them in every good work and work. Listen to that. We have hope in Jesus. And our hope does not disappoint. Our hope in Jesus comforts us. It opens our eyes to what Jesus is saying, to what the Spirit leads us in. It comforts our hearts. I don't know how people don't want God. I don't know how they can get through hard stuff without God on their side, or a church family. I don't know how they do it. With no hope in sight? I mean, even science has said that hope is a healer. Now, hopefully you have hope in Jesus, but if you put hope in other things in the future, a lot of times you heal faster. It's when your attitude changes and you have no hope, and that's when you hurt yourself or you hurt others or you just don't want to live. But there's hope in God. He establishes us in His work, in His hand, so we may do good works and have good works. You see how that works? Jesus did the work first, and then we do it because He did it first. Not because we work out our salvation and then we're like, God, you owe me. No, Jesus did all the work first. He loved us, even before we were born. Oh, man, yesterday I was born a baby. I love baby. Smell and little nose and just want eat them up. I always thought my mom was weird when she says that. I just want to eat you up. Cannibal. Anyway, holding a baby. It's awesome. It's just a wonderful feeling of hope. And God does that work. And a woman knits it together. The cells and the beautiful image. I mean, it's crazy that we can actually make pictures and see 3D objects of the baby inside. Just amazing. Amazing. When Katie was pregnant with Isla, just see the feet come up from just, I mean, she was a kicker. And Angel was a hiccup. Like, you could just see her dog. Just hiccuped all the time. But that was a blessing. That was hope. And I can't wait for Jesus to come back. But until then, we have hope that He is with us. And He is graceful and compassionate and comfort. And it gives us hope so we can do the good work and speak the good word. We don't have to worry about what's going on in the world. Now, should we be vigilant and knowing what it is? Yes. I have no problem with watching news, but you have to put it in light of what? In light of God. That's what we forget sometimes. We get so down on the physical that we're like, oh, it's going to be this, it's going to be the war, it's going to be over here, it's going to be over there, that we just lose sight of the spiritual. And Jesus came for us to have open eyes to the spiritual, to have a new heart, a new soul, a new hope, not to focus on the physical all the time. God is still God when our physical bodies fail us. God is still God when there's wars. God is still God if somebody is hurting you. God is still God when we have somebody die. God is still God when we go through anything, insert whatever anything you have. We keep forgetting that just because we go through something bad doesn't necessarily mean God is bad. It's sin that is bad. We are in a fallen world. But when we have hope, we can get through it. We can get through maturing in Christ, memorizing the truth. Because one of these days, we're going to come after this and learn it. We've got to memorize this stuff. We've got to put it in our heart. We've got to put it here. If history repeats itself, they're going to come after this. There are nations right now underground, literally and sometimes figuratively, underground, that each person memorizes a whole book of the Bible. And the person who wants to hear it, they go to that person because they can't carry this around. Most of your communist states, countries, will not let you have this. And don't think for one second that it won't come to America. We have to memorize it. We have to be in it. Because where does God say this should be? In our hearts. I don't know how to stuff it in my heart unless you memorize it. I'm like, how do you memorize that stuff? Well, the Spirit helps you. And the Spirit will talk when it comes up, when it needs to come up. Because I've memorized all this stuff, but you think I could do it right here and right now? Probably not, unless the Spirit says, oh, that's the scripture, that's good. You should see my notes sometime. I should publish my notes. Half the stuff I put in here, we don't use, because Jesus should be speaking through us. When we look at the Word, when we look at the truth, when we have hope, He is speaking through us. As long as it goes in the light of. Now, why am I going back to God all the time? Because if it's not of God, it's of the world. And we don't want to be of the world. We don't want to be of the lawlessness. We want to be with hope and comfort in Jesus. In the Message, I usually use the Message, but sometimes it has a really cool explanation. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 through 14 says this in the Message. And regarding the question, friends, that has come up about what happens to those already dead and buried, we don't want you in the dark any longer. First off, you must not carry on over them like people who have nothing to look forward to, as if the grave were the last words. Since Jesus died and broke loose from the grave, God will most certainly bring back to life those who died in Jesus. Isn't that great? The more I think about my mother-in-law or the people who have passed away in my life, the more I want to be with them, the more I want to be with Jesus, the more I want to be in heaven. And that brings me home. Now, did I cry that physically Paulette Watkins died? Yes. It broke my heart and I cried out to God. But He comforted me. And I'm going to see her again. Just like Jesus died and He resurrected, He's at the right hand of God, and we're going to see Him again. Man, I don't know about you, but I'm going to be hugging Him longer than you. Just one day. You better get in line. He is so much more than the man of lawlessness. He is so much more than Katie. He is so much more than you. He is so much more than my friends and my enemies. He is so much more than myself. I literally love Jesus so much that I hate myself. And you're like, what? Not literally. But I will do nothing to put myself on a pedestal. I will put Jesus on a pedestal. I will suffer because He is my hope. And if we have that attitude, I don't care what the man of lawlessness does to me. Do it. Because you can't take my soul. Jesus already had it. So, guys, don't worry about those things. Now, should we study? Should we study Scripture? Should we plan ahead? Sure. But that's not where our hope is. Our hope is in Jesus and in His grace and in His way. Let's reflect on that, because He should be the hope that we have, not this physical world. Let's pray. God, thank You so much as we reflect on these things that You will be the one who triumphs. We know that Paul wrote this for the first century church, but also he wrote it for us so we may know that no matter what happens in the world, You're in control. You will come back for Your kingdom. God, we thank You that we can put hope in You and comfort in You and know the truth that You've written down. Help us to do that more so we may not be deceived by those who are coming, or already have come. God, let us put our trust in You and not the world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. heard somebody say one time that they love that we do communion almost to the end, because it's like that pinnacle. It's like the last thought before you leave. That Jesus came, he was innocent, he died, he was in the grave for 3 days, he rose again, and now he's sitting at the right hand of God. And because of that, we want to proclaim to the world of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And it brings us hope. Communion, this time, should not be like, well, we're running late, we've got to do this. No, it should be a hopeful thing that we're pointing to Jesus, and it starts our week. It's just, it's an awesome thing to be with you, the body of Christ, to think of the body of Christ. Isn't that awesome? Through his hope. So, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 and 2 says this. Now, concerning the coming of Lord Jesus Christ, or being gathered together to him. What are we doing right now? We're gathered together to him. We don't come to church just to sit in nice pews. We come to church because we are the church. And we're gathered to him. We ask you, brothers and sisters, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or spoken word or letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. We do this because we want the day of the Lord to come. Not that it's already come. It is coming. And we're going to be so joyful and overjoyed to be with our brothers and sisters in Christ when the world is persecuting us. Because we're together here and we're going to be together there. And until that day, we're going to have the bread that represents Jesus' body and the juice that represents Jesus' blood. And so while the music is playing, we're going to hold that and then we're going to take it together as the body of Christ, which is called the church. Remember the body of Christ. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this time that we have in service, that we can just individually be with you and corporately as the body of Christ. Remember your death, burial, and resurrection. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for your hope that's in Jesus Christ. Help us to get deeper into your word. Help us to just love you more and love others. Just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Everyone tries with their best.
death, and own resurrection of Jesus, he does wrap his arm around us and gives us hope in those times. Let's partake together. Stand together. So Jesus gives us hope. If you want to know Jesus, you just put your faith in Jesus, and then because of your faith, you should be wanting to do what God wants us to do. And so because of that faith, we move ourselves to repent and confess Jesus' name, to be baptized, and to keep that faith forever. And so because of our faith in Jesus, because of his work, he saves, and it's Jesus who saves. And through our faith, we do these things for his glory and his kingdom. And so if you have any questions for that, or if you want to come to Jesus, you know, the Bible tells you how to do it. Other Christians can help you. I can help you. Or just do it. Because Jesus is always listening. And he's always faithful. And he's always coming. I don't know how to implore you anymore, because he is coming back, and sooner than later. You need Jesus. If you don't have faith in Jesus, you're going to miss it. I don't want you missing it. Put your faith in Jesus. Come to Jesus. I'm going to say that every Sunday. You'll probably get sick and tired of it, but that's okay. Because God tells us it's Jesus who saves, not me. And so Jesus is more important. Let's pray. God, thank you so much. Your hope is so great. You do put your arm around us. We might not understand. We might get upset. But God, you are always faithful. Help us to deepen our faith in you, no matter what's around us. Help us to think spiritually and give you the glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Have a great week.
All right.